So we're transitioning mics here, I think with success. Thanks, Bonnie, and thanks, Jim. That was a great film. And I guess I just have to say I never quite get the tie thing right, I guess. So here I am with a tie, which actually I think about when I showed up the Smithsonian without a tie. Actually, they like that. Because I think too many people wear ties in that city. Anyway, it's great to be here in beautiful Jackson Hole, and thank you all very much for taking time out of your evening to be here. And I guess like most speakers like myself say, I'm excited. So, and I really am, seriously. I have had a passion, as Bonnie said, for Yellowstone's grizzly bears for a long time. I mean, I'm deeply interested in grizzly bears, the ecology of grizzly bears, their behavior. So I guess if I were to try to essentialize what it is I'm going to try to do tonight, first of all, I'm going to try to share with you part of why I think not just grizzly bears in general, but grizzly bears in the Yellowstone ecosystem are so extraordinary, so special. And I would even call some aspects of them miraculous. So I hope to enhance your sense of appreciation for these animals. The other thing I'd like to do is give you some information about what's happened in the past, what's happening now, what's likely to happen in the future with this population, and primarily so you have a better basis, as Bonnie was saying, for, I guess, judging for yourself what might be going on. So I'm going to try to cover a lot of ground, hopefully in an engaging way. But I have to confess, it's going to be pretty science geeky compared to Jim's film. But like I say, hopefully in an engaging way. But before I get into the meat of it, again, I'd like to acknowledge the sponsors of this evening's event, the Sierra Club, Wyoming Wildlife Advocates, the Cougar Fund, Center for Biological Diversity, and also my affiliations, which I probably don't need to go through again. Just to note the Northern Rockies Conservation Cooperative, because of its local venue. So again, a somewhat involved talk. So probably in service of that, I should provide a little bit of a roadmap. And where am I headed? Well, first of all, I'm going to talk a little bit about what makes a bear. What is it about a bear? When you see it, you know it's a bear. What goes on underneath its skin that's pretty extraordinary and bear-like? Arrivals and departures, a little history. Then I'm going to talk about the diet of Yellowstone's grizzly bears in particular, and much about what makes that extraordinary, unique, special. Then, once having established the benchmark of important foods, talk a little bit about the effects of those foods and diet on birth and death rates of this population. Also about what's been happening with those foods. And then concluding with a very brief examination of what's going on with population trend and distribution. Each piece builds on the other. So hopefully you will see it all as an arc and of a piece. So what makes a bear? You know, what is it about a bear? When you go out there, you say, that's a bear. And it's probably stuff that's pretty damned obvious that you probably may not even think about. I don't even think about it. What's beyond that, I guess, especially unique and distinctive. And probably the best place to start in broaching that topic is to look at the seasonal cycle of grizzly bears. And what I've done here is broken out the course of the year, starting with January 1st through December 30th, by Julian date, which is sort of the arcane way that scientists often do this. I'm going to have an event timeline. And above that, I'm going to represent activities of bears during the course of the year. And where I'd like to start is with denning. So the blue shaded areas correspond to the percent of the population that's in dens, and different shades of blue, different sex, age, reproductive cohorts. The lightest blue, females with cubs. So anywhere from 4 to 6 months in a den. And what I like about this graphic is it gives, I think, a fairly compelling visual image of how much time bears spend curled up in a hole in the ground. Just think of that. Anyway, okay, so think of it. course, obviously, then bears come out and they start feeding. But the level of feeding is not constant during the course of the year. And what I've shown here is sort of a summary representation of various indices of level of feeding activity peaking about now, beginning about now, mid-July and on, during a period that's called hyperphagia, which active eating, overeating. It's during this period of time that bears accumulate most of the body fat that will sustain them through the following winter and then the dearth of the following spring. And what about breeding season, estrus? Notice that it happens when feeding levels or feeding activities are lowest. And that's not by coincidence. It turns out that bears breed when there's the least rich food in their habitat. And they schedule breeding so that they don't interfere with feeding when they need to be feeding most. And think about it, that's just the opposite of what you see with grazers, like elk, bison, deer. They focus on feeding early in the year when there's this pulse of rich food that moves through their habitat, and they breed later in the year. But there's a perfect logic to all that. Okay, so let's say that fertilization of the egg happens. Well, something really peculiar goes on then. The egg multiplies. We end up with a ball of cells called a blastocyst. And this blastocyst doesn't implant. It's free-floating for upwards of 170 days. So the female has not yet made a commitment to pregnancy. So think about that. It allows her, figuratively speaking, and I'm taking liberties here in how I represent this, to assess her body condition before she makes a commitment to pregnancy. And then, so it's an inexpensive way to abort then, if you haven't achieved that 20% body fat. So let's say she's of adequate condition. Implantation happens after she's in the den sometime in November, and then a remarkably short period of gestation, only 2 months, after which a remarkably small cub is born. And thereafter nursed. So just to give you a sense of how small, I won't afflict you with too many of these XY diagrams, but this is a science talk after all. To put this in perspective then, each one of those gray dots represents data for a single species. So there's hundreds of placental mammal species represented here. What I've shown on the vertical axis is the size of the newborn. What I've shown on the Y-axis, the bottom axis, is the size of the mom. And this is the major trend line. And of course, as you might suspect, these are the bear species. So relative to the size of the mom, bears give birth to the smallest young of essentially any placental mammal. So the only way that a bear can carry this off, at least in northern latitudes, is because they give birth to cubs in dens, where it's safe and secure for a helpless small cub. So that takes me back to hibernation. And the only word I can think of to describe hibernation in bears is miraculous. So while they're in their den, they don't urinate, they don't defecate, they don't eat, they don't drink. 4 to 6 months. Nor do they lose muscle mass or strength, nor do they lose bone density or strength, nor do they experience kidney failure. For any, how many people here are in the medical community? A nurse, doctor? Oh my God. You know, I mean, how do they do it? Well, medical researchers have been trying to unlock that secret for the last several decades. We know a lot more than we did, but the secrets are still unmasked, if you will. But the implications for humans are obvious. For bedbound people, for astronauts in hibernation traveling to another planet. And then we have these small cubs. Well, why the small cub in the short gestation? Well, it turns out that as long as a female tries to sustain a fetus through the placenta, she draws on her muscle mass, her lean body mass, and she produces toxic waste that have to be processed by the kidney. So it makes sense for her to get that little thing out as quickly as she can and transition to sustaining it through lactation from her body fat, which she can readily replenish. What else about a bear? Well, something, again, that we may see but we don't see. Obesity. Bears are the most obese terrestrial mammal that we have. They cart around 20 to 40% body fat. Now, that obviously the body fat is key to their life cycle. It gets them through hibernation and the dearth of next spring. But the price they pay is that it costs them more energetically to cart all that bulk around, and they're not as fast as you would expect for their size, so at a price. Something related, the front limbs. You know, if I were to ask you what makes a bear, probably not very many people would say, well, the front limbs. Well, I would say the front limbs, actually. They're the most dexterous of large carnivores. By the data, they're the most dexterous, which is associated with them being flat-footed, walking plantigrade. They have massive forelimbs anchored to a robust, massive scapula, surmounted by massive suprascapular muscles that constitute the hump in the case of grizzly bears. So you're getting this picture of incredibly strong forequarters that power these flexible paws. And so that allows smaller species like black bears to climb trees. In the case of grizzly bears, grapple with prey, thanks to Charlie Russell here. A little imaginative, I think. Also, excavate underground foods, which brings me to a foreshadowing of some of what makes Yellowstone's grizzly bear diet so unique. A lot of the root foods they eat, yampa, sweet sisley, biscuit root, spring beauty, and also underground dwelling rodents like pocket gopher and the root caches that pocket gophers make. So this brings me to an interlude. So I've been highlighting that which is different about bears. Well, there's actually a lot, though, that they share that they have in common with us. They're whimsical, intelligent omnivores. They stand on their hind legs. If you skin them out, they look remarkably like a human. The mothers provide extended maternal care. Again, think of 399. And all of that, then, has instilled a profound sense of respect and kinship amongst native peoples for millennia. 40,000 years, more, manifest in stories represented here by this painting, the most famous of which, The Woman Who Married the Bear, probably the most widespread story once upon a time in the entire world, throughout the Northern Hemisphere. One variant of this is of the woman marrying the bear, going to his lodge. Her brothers follow her, track her to her lodge, kill her bear husband. She kills her brothers, gives birth to two cubs, or two offspring that are half bear, half man, shapeshifters that then become teachers and messengers between the bear world and the human world. So, it doesn't surprise me that most of the people that have lived on Earth with bears have probably felt this way about bears. Grizzly bears in particular. So this brings me to history. Arrivals and departures. So when and how did grizzlies arrive on this continent? Sort of a starting point. Here you're looking at North America, approximately what it looked like roughly 80,000 years ago. You can see the ice sheets. I delineated Yellowstone. The reason I highlight 80,000 years ago is that was about the last time when there was passage open to Beringia. Realizing grizzly bears came from Asia. And there's good evidence that grizzly bears were here by at least 32,000 years ago. So the only window that I can come up with when they could have gotten into the mid part of this continent was between roughly 60 and 80,000 years ago. A genetic variant of bears, the first migrants called clade 4. You can think of that roughly as a subspecies. So clade 4 bears arrived. The door figuratively slammed shut. The ice sheets merged. And I don't doubt that the bears spread out, but I would suspect they lived at a low density or in safe refuges. And why? Because they arrived to find all of these guys. A whole bestiary of large carnivores that were fierce competitors, no doubt, also predators. Think the giant short-faced bear there to the right and the American lion. We had lions and packs. I wouldn't want to be around. So about 13,500 years ago, the ice sheets had again begun to melt. A corridor opened again up to Beringia. Most of the other large carnivores were well on their way to extinction. The world had opened up for grizzly bears, and they spread out. Some even into eastern North America, where they were for a couple of millennia. Others of clade 4 moving north. But at the same time, several other waves of migrant bears had come over from Asia of another genetic clade. They were spreading south. They met somewhere in the middle of Alberta. Probably the important point to take away here is that the bears in Yellowstone are descendants of clade 4 bears, that first wave of migrant bears that have been here for 60,000 years, more. So I'm going to jump over a lot of really fascinating history up to the time of first substantial contact between Europeans and bears around 1800. What you see in green is what I've been able to reconstruct as grizzly bear range about that time based on a lot of data that I could, all the data I could find. By 1850, bears were extirpated from the central and southern plains. By 1910, they had been extirpated from 90% of their former range and reduced to these little green patches and blobs. Some of these so-called populations were only a couple of bears. And a short 50 years later, we had lost all the bears but for those that we have basically now in the northern Rocky Mountains, a few bears perhaps in the North Cascades, a few bears perhaps in the San Juan Mountains. As to why we saw these widespread and massive extirpations, pretty straightforward. It was European settlers. Here represented by this rogues gallery of bear killers, Custer to the left, Ben Lilly second from the right. He was a paid government killer, government bear killer in Arizona, New Mexico. Our European ancestors were remarkably lethal to grizzly bears. I think it would be fair to say that virtually every grizzly bear that encountered an armed European between 1800 and 1950 ended up dead. So what was going on? I would say a lot of what was going on was, in addition to Europeans having large caliber firearms, it had to do with what was going on between their ears. And that had to do with stories like Manifest Destiny, which was a story of domination, use, and death. And I don't want to be overly dramatic here, but in thinking about this story, it essentially gave European settlers permission in their minds to perpetrate genocides. And I would apply the term broadly if I were to include other beings besides humans in that phenomenon. Emblematic of that, look what's being swept away before European settlers. Bears, bison, native peoples. Going back to the map, here's Yellowstone, and I think the important point to take away here is that Yellowstone's grizzly bears are completely isolated and have been isolated for a while, which raises several issues, concerns about genetic health, also increases the vulnerability of a population like this, any isolated population, to variation in habitat conditions, and also in the case of bears, variation in human lethality. So that's sort of some background. Let's start drilling into Yellowstone's grizzly bears. And I benchmarked this as 75 to 2005 because a lot in the world of grizzly bears changed after 2005, and starting with their diet, which should be 2005, not 4, but anyway, never mind. And what I'd like to start out with is talking about something you rarely hear mentioned or discussed, which I think is extraordinarily important, and that is that there is no other bear population, brown, grizzly, otherwise, in the entire world that eats a diet even closely resembling that of Yellowstone's grizzly bears. And I would consider that and the behaviors attached to that to be an essential part of the biodiversity that is part of Yellowstone's grizzly bears. I value it. I appreciate it. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And I could go through an incredible laundry list, but just pulling one out of the grab bag, let's talk about pondweed. You can see the floating leaves here on this pond. That's pondweed. By the fall, some of these ponds drain, and you see the desiccated leaves then of pondweed on that drained pond bottom. Bears such as this family group then come in and essentially rototilled upon bottom looking for the starchy rhizomes of pondweed. And here I've masked out everything that they haven't rototilled. Where's the sum total of the locations we know on Earth where bears have dug for pondweed? The black dots here. And you can see the boundary of Yellowstone Park, you can see Yellowstone Lake, you can see in orange the rhyolite plateaus, you can see the dashed line, the caldera boundary. So just about all of the feeding on pondweed root has occurred within the caldera boundaries in Yellowstone. The only other place on Earth where I think bears might have been documented digging pondweed is around Lake Baikal in Siberia. So again, the list is enough to bore you to, anyway. But let's talk about a couple of the more common important foods. Pondweed is not that big of a food for grizzlies in Yellowstone, but let's talk about the ones that are also singular. Bison. And needless to say, wherever bears can get a hold of a bison carcass, it's an important source of food. So let's look at where there were both grizzly bears and bison, say around 1800, there. Point is that grizzly bears were living with bison and potentially the majority of the historical range. And I would argue in that area of overlap, bison was probably a critically important food for grizzly bears. And this is what we have left because of extirpations of bison and grizzly bears here alone in Yellowstone. This is a relic of a behavior that was once widespread. Now, we're probably not going to lose bison, but if we were, it would be gone. It would be over. There would be no more of it. So that's important to keep in mind, I think. At least, I think it's important. Something similar with whitebark pine, which produces cones from which bears extract seeds, which they eat. Something similar here, overlap of whitebark pine with grizzly bears in green. And because of major losses of whitebark pine to insects and disease, because of extirpations of grizzly bears, this is about the only place in North America where you see grizzly bears eating lots of pine seeds. So again, a remnant, a relic. But interestingly enough, when you step back and look at the entire northern hemisphere and look at the totality of brown and grizzly bear range here in light tan with the dark brown lines, everything within that that's a shade of green is where you have stone pines and bears. Stone pines, whitebark pine is one of the stone pines. And it turns out that in Siberia, stone pine seeds are one of the most important foods of bears there. So in some respects, bears in Yellowstone are more like bears in Siberia than they are bears anywhere else in North America, which I think is pretty cool. So going back to the constellation of foods that make bears here unique, for example, they eat lots of mushrooms, false truffles, earthworms, so on. But as it turns out, at least historically, they got the vast majority of their nutrients and energy from just four foods. Cutthroat trout, whitebark pine seeds, meat from bison and elk, and army cutworm moths. To put that in unnecessarily graphic numeric form, what I show here by the height of these bars, different colors, the contribution of different three foods here, not all four, but just three of the foods, to ingested volume, digested energy, ingested fat, ingested protein of the historical grizzly bear diet. This is the contribution of meat, pine seeds, trout. So mammals contributed most to protein, I'll leave it at that, whitebark pine proportionally most to fat, and cutthroat trout to protein as well. So this gives you a feel for it. A little bit more about cutthroat trout. Just about all of the trout consumed by bears occurred in streams tributary to Yellowstone Lake, here shown in blue. To put that in spatial context, here you see the full distribution of Yellowstone's bears, the boundary of Yellowstone Park, Yellowstone Lake. The black and gray are zones of influence that I would attribute to these spawning streams. And at one time, that's what the spawning runs looked like, tributary to Yellowstone Lake. Between roughly mid-May through the end of July, which is when bears congregated there using various techniques to obtain the fish, consuming 40, 80 pounds of fish in a day. Anyway, a lot of calories. A little bit about army cutworm moths. Feeding on moths themselves occur in some of the highest, rugged, most remote parts of the ecosystem, up and around alpine talus like this. The moths are there, having migrated from the Great Plains to feed on the nectar of tundra flowers. And so during the day, when the moths are congregated in the talus slopes, the bears show up, rummage around in the talus, and extract, as some people have called them, these little fat bombs. And there's been estimated that a bear can eat as many as 40,000 moths in a sitting, mid-July through mid-September. And I'd say most of the bears on the east side of the ecosystem do this anymore. So just a little bit more about white bark pine, having to do with differences between the sexes. What I've done here is broken out the active season into four periods. You can see hyperphasia there farthest to the right, early and late. The height of the bars can correspond to the level of feeding activity associated with pine seeds for males versus females. Turns out that females much more often fed on pine seeds compared to males. In fact, when you put it all together, females ate roughly twice as many pine seeds as males did. So I guess it would be fair to say that pine seeds were more of a female food than a male food. Females here were uniquely dependent on pine seeds. Turning to ungulates. Historically, bears got probably the majority of their meat from elk, followed by bison, followed by moose, and virtually nothing at all from livestock and mule deer, historically. Again, looking at the different periods of the active season, we have a pattern here that's a reverse of what we saw with pine seeds. This is level of feeding on meat from ungulates. Again, differentiating females from males, and here the pattern is reversed, especially during hyperphasia. Males ate a lot more meat than females did, so this was sort of a male strategy, and sort of a crude estimate of how much meat an adult male would eat in a year, about 700 pounds, about 42% by predation. Adult females, two-thirds less, only a quarter by predation. Juvenile males, similar statistics. Juvenile females, least of all. So again, meat eating was a male strategy. So I'm going to get to this a little later, but think about a female adopting a male strategy. It means you'll run into a lot more males, probably. So the effects of these foods on birth and death rates, which is sort of the bottom line reckoning. And I have to go back to what makes bears special or distinctive and provide a little more context. What I've done here is assembled data on 720 different mammals and rank ordered them from left to right, highest to lowest, the number of offspring produced per year of reproductive life. And as you probably have guessed, the red bar represents grizzly bears. They are one of the slowest reproducing of all mammals. The only ones that reproduce at a slower rate typically are the marine mammals. They only produce one female cub every 3 years. Once they start reproducing, it takes between 8 and 11 years typically to replace themselves because not all cubs survive. So what do we know about the effects of diet on reproductive rates? Strong effect of white bark pine seeds. Females that ate more of those had more often had 3 cub litters, the normal being 2. Females that ate more meat more often had the normal 2 cubs, but then more often lost one of those. Females that ate more roots more often had a 1 cup litter. And so the difference between the effect of white bark pine and roots is pretty readily understood in terms of nutrition. But what about the effect of meat? Why would a female more often lose a cub? Well, think back to what I just said. If you adopt a male dietary strategy, you're going to be more often running into males. And in fact, early on in the study, just about all of the losses that we knew the cause of that we would consider natural were from predation by other bears. When we put it all together, though, the strongest detected effect is that of white bark pine seeds. Following a good crop, we had half again more number of cubs being produced. Turning to effects of diet on death rates. Here again, we have a major effect of pine seeds. And to understand that effect, first of all, you've got to appreciate how variable pine seed production was historically. Here, what we see represented by the green dots is the number of cones counted on trees at fixed transects. The point here, highly variable, 1 year to the next, with consequences for the bears represented by this XY diagram. On the y-axis, the vertical, are the number of bears that were trapped during a given year because of conflicts with humans, a pretty good indicator of overall levels of conflict. What you see on the bottom axis, the x-axis, are amount of pine seeds consumed. You can see there's a fairly nice negative relationship. The point being that when bears ate more pine seeds, there were fewer conflicts with people. And that's because they were in white bark pine forests, which are fairly remote, not often used by people. When they didn't have pine seeds to eat, they tended to spend more time near people, got into more conflict more often, ended up dead. So if we look at the, sort of the net effect of pine seeds, we find that death rates could double during years when we had poor seed crops. So a point I'd like to make here is that this is the strongest effect of a food on birth and death rates that has ever been documented for a brown or grizzly bear population anywhere in the world. So this is non-trivial. So with that as a benchmark, what's been happening to these key foods? And this brings me to what I would call the good years between 75 and 95. A lot more meat on the hoof by 1995 compared to 1975. This shows trend lines for our two largest elk herds at top, our two bison herds at bottom. All the trends are positive, some substantially so. What about cutthroat trout? Well, these yellow bars represent the results of a comprehensive survey of spawning streams done by Bill Hoskins in the mid-1970s. Number of streams with spawning trout, number of streams with bear sign, with sign of bear fishing. Dan Reinhart, sitting right there, repeated these surveys in the mid-1980s and came up with these results, roughly the same number of spawning streams, but look at the increase in level of bear activity and bear fishing. It was like a fourfold increase. A lot of that was driven by increases in cutthroat trout populations, which peaked in Yellowstone Lake actually in the 1970s, early 1980s. What about army cutworm moths? So if somebody had asked me in 1982 whether bears in Yellowstone ate army cutworm moths, I would have said no, and I would have been right, but then shortly wrong. By 1986, we detected bears consuming pine seeds up in the alpine. That the number of sites being used is represented by the green dots and green lines. The number of bears on those sites by the gray dots and gray line. The trend's obvious. A dramatic increase. In fact, I would argue that at least within the context of the last 50 years, the discovery and use of an altogether new, rich food. Again, almost wholly on the east and southeast margins of the ecosystem. Those are the good years. The bad years, at least in terms of habitat trends, starting roughly 1995. The case of white bark pine. There was a comprehensive survey of white bark pine stands done in 2009 assessing levels of mortality. These different colors represent the full extent of white bark pine distribution in this ecosystem. The star is where we are. To interpret these colors, gray is where virtually all of the mature cone-producing white bark pine were dead. Red, where the stands were well on their way to that state. Green represents the only stands that were relatively healthy at that time. And the trend since then has not been particularly positive. And this is for just for cone-producing mature trees. But the point is, within a 10-year period, we functionally lost one of the big four foods in a good part of this ecosystem. Nothing that I could have ever imagined would happen. Again, if you talked to me in the 1980s, 1990s, out of the friggin' blue, at least for somebody like me. And this was all because of bark beetles. And there's one hypothesis that this outbreak of bark beetles is driven by climate warming. I'm convinced. Something similar with cutthroat trout. The graph at top shows the results of two different indices of cutthroat trout population size traced over time. You can see a dramatic increase to, you call it functional extirpation. There's been a brief upblip or a little bit of an upblip lately, but compared to the populations of cutthroat trout we had in the 70s and 80s, you know, whatever. Hardly of any consequence, at least functionally. As to why? Well, some of it was due to the fact that we had lake trout introduced illegally in the mid-1990s, and lake trout prey on cutthroat trout. But also, it turns out that there's some fairly compelling research implicating changed hydrologic regimes driven by climate warming. So here, climate warming is yet another, yet again implicated as a smoking gun. Not surprisingly, this is the trend line for bear activity around the streams, down to the point where now virtually no bears fish for cutthroat trout anymore. So essentially lost two of the big four foods. Well, having implicated climate warming, what does the future hold? And these are projections for temperature from 2000 to 2100 and precipitation, top, bottom, three different scenarios. You know, pretty straightforward. It's going to be a lot warmer. We're going to have more moisture, but that's going to be offset by the warming, so it's going to be net drier. Not very auspicious. So, okay, so the bears lost trout, lost most of the whitebark pine. They must be eating something. Let's go back to army cutworm moths and that trend line. Look what happened within just the last couple of years. Same number of sites, but look at the number of bears on those sites. I have no doubt that on the east side of the ecosystem, more bears are spending more time eating cutworm moths. The east side is actually, if you remember that map, where we've lost a lot of the whitebark pine. So I think that's been a compensatory turn. Is that a food resource we want to count on for the indefinite future? Remembering the link of cutworm moths to tundra. Every projection I've seen with climate warming is that the climate envelope for tundra is going to essentially disappear. We're projected to lose 90% of the alpine by 2100. Probably bears are eating more meat, almost certainly more meat from elk and bison, indicated here by a trend line indicating increasing meat from 2002-2009 based on the analysis of tissues, an indicator of meat consumption. There's other lines of evidence substantiating this turn to meat. And there's various lines of evidence suggesting that a lot of that increased meat consumption has come from bears preying more heavily on elk calves. In some places, elk mortality rates have tripled. And a lot of that has been driven by bear predation, not just grizzly predation, but black bear predation. But there's some problems with the turn to meat. Because in contrast to 75 to 95, there's a lot less meat on the hoof now, around 2010, compared to what we had in 1990. This shows trends for virtually every elk population within occupied grizzly bear habitat, the large herds at top, small herds at the bottom. Every trend is negative but one. Some of these trends are catastrophic, I would argue. The Firehole Madison herd, just about gone. The only herd that's hanging in there is the Upper Madison herd. What about bison? Mixed story. We've seen pretty major declines in the size of the central herd recently. The good news is the northern herd has increased, so at least for the bears in that part of the Yellowstone ecosystem, they have potentially more meat from bison to eat. But there's something even more problematic about this turn to eating meat, and that has to do with the hazards that bears eating meat incur. And a lot of those hazards, not all of them, but a lot of them, are driven by people. So emblematic of that, look at the red dots. This shows the number of bears dying because of encounters with hunters. You'll notice the sharp, sharp upturn beginning about 2007. There's been a downturn, but levels of hunter-caused mortality still remain at unprecedented highs, and that's despite the fact, represented by these gray dots, that numbers of hunters afield have dropped by half, by 50%. Okay, let's benchmark when we lost most of the whitebark pine. Looking at conflict and deaths related to livestock, orange dots are numbers of conflicts, red dots, number of bears dying because of conflicts with livestock. Again, benchmarked against when we lost whitebark pine. Bottom line, eating meat is a hazardous endeavor for virtually every bear that embarks upon that course. And remember, not just for the adult bears, but also for cubs. Cubs of females that eat more meat tend to be more often killed by other bears, and also, since reintroduction of wolves, occasionally by wolves. So meat is a fine food. It's a good food, nutritionally. There's a lot of fat, as you know, on an elk in the fall. But boy, you wouldn't want to count on staying alive if you were a bear eating meat. So very briefly, I'm coming to the end, what's happening with the population? So I'm going to focus on trend. The gray dots at top represent a median estimate for an indicator of total population size using the latest adopted method, one that's considered to be a bit less biased than the method that was used before. I won't talk about the rather bizarre increase that's biologically impossible at the very beginning, but let's fit a trend line to that population estimate beginning roughly 2002. There's no evidence of any increase. So population, by this indicator, has been flat. If you fit a trend line to more recent years, even an indication of a decline. Let's benchmark that against loss of white bark pine. Any other indicators of trouble potentially afoot at the population level? Here, what I've done is prorated number of bears dying against number of bears of each sex that we think were alive in the ecosystem. So an index of death rate, not just size, but rate. And again, a very dramatic, to my eye, very dramatic increase, some downturn. But boy, by all indications, death rate is much, much higher, sort of taking a real-time look like this, than it was, you know, beginning roughly in 2005. Again, hard on the heels of losing white bark pine. And I would say that a lot of this has been driven by the turn to meat and coincides with the slight downturn in the population. Point is, too, to bear in mind that there are long, long lag effects for bear populations between when you lose a food and when you pick that up in what's happening with the population. And if you think that what you see today is what's going to happen 5 years from now, you're going to be sadly mistaken. I guess that's my soapbox. So, concluding topic, distribution. At the same time, then, we've had no increase of late, but an increase in population up till probably about 2000. What's been happening with where bears are in this ecosystem, the extent of that distribution? The green blob here is where we think bears were around 1970. You can see Yellowstone Park there, kind of as a shadow in the background. Here's Jackson. So this is where we thought they were in the mid-1980s. Thank you.
When you put the chart on about the stability of the population, what was the number that you were referring to that had been stated in that? Uses 800 these days, and U.S. Fish and Wildlife uses 1,000 to 1,200. So
okay.
I'm completely on the opposite tack than what you're suggesting.
We said. Well, that bear is commonly seen around Jackson Lake and the northern part of Grand Teton National Park. She's been seen by millions of people, you know, locals and visitors over the years.
Well, if you're not comfortable with a thousand bears and the management goal by the different agencies, if they're delisted, it's 500 bears. How do you feel about that?
What do you think the effect has been on reintroduction of wolves into the ecosystem? In my observations, wolves often make the kill, but bears eat the food. And that's just one part of it.
The wolf feed,
just two thoughts. When you speak about connectivity, I don't know if people here know about Fido Brown, but they work really hard. They're out of Montana to connect the distribution, you know, the lands connecting the bears that are separated. So if you're interested in that, that's a really Fido Brown is the name of that place. And the other thing I wanted to say is, if an endangered species can't be safe in a national park, what's going on here? And what can we really do to protect these animals? I mean, is it all political? Is it? Like, sometimes you get those beautiful photographs out there, people learn to appreciate instead of fear the animals, and more people care about it. You see videos on YouTube with a bear with cubs surrounded on both sides of a high bridge, and when she runs to escape the situation and save her young, the caption is, you know, the bear is chasing people. You know, I mean, what do we need to do to change that perception of the man-eating beast, and also to persuade people that these creatures are valuable and we can make room for them? I mean, who do we need to push? I mean, you can, you know, all of this scientific information, all of these intellectual connections to this bear, it's really compelling. It's fascinating, it's engaging. And we have an audience for that, and we have a culture for that here in Jackson. But the problems themselves have a cultural element to which we don't have the tools and the capacity to come up against at this point. What do you see as, how do we integrate? How do we become a constituency within a culture? How do we get this constituency here for the fascinating, scientific, fun, intellectually engaging part? How do we integrate into the nitty-gritty of the cultural change that needs to happen? I would just challenge everybody in this room right now, if we had this kind of attendance to the meeting where decision making happens, that would be a tidal wave, that would be a force.
An arcane question about the army cutworms. You say that they come from the Great Plains. Is there any threat to them in that part of the life cycle? And also, is the pollination study of what plants the moth are using, did anybody finish that study? Because I never did see a conclusion of that.
So if we acknowledge that grizzly bears are basically contained within a set geographical area because of the recovery plan and because of what state management might be implied for them, how do we reverse the trend of stable or declining grizzly bears, given that most of the food sources are declining, we are not going to allow them to expand outside of a given geometrical area, and connectivity, even if it were to be accomplished, is still happening within a set of circumstances where we're still reducing the population.
extent can the genetic isolation of our Yellowstone grizzlies be, to a certain extent, vetted by importing boars from the Northern Rockies or further up in British Columbia? And to what extent is that scientifically worthwhile?
Biodiversity by bringing in bears, but the Yellowstone bears, as you showed, have such a different, diverse diet. If you brought in bears from there, would they even survive? Thank you.